I think the second series of engineering connections kind of, well, as you'd expect, moves it on. Because as a thing, I now know better what we're trying to do, there's a confidence that comes with it. Because by definition, if what you're doing is making programs about structures and machines, incredible feats of engineering, and then the links, the connections to other engineering feats, what that means in essence is you're making programs about interesting facts about interesting things, which is kind of a nice place to be, having to smooth out. There are some programs you make that are fun because you like that. There are some programs you make that are fun just because of what in them. This is fun to make because of what it's actually about. It's the facts that drive it. That's what I love about doing it. It's about the subject. It's not about what I think about it. It's about the subject, about the facts. And therefore, all I'm doing every day is getting up, going somewhere, anywhere in the world, and finding out about really interesting stuff. So why wouldn't that be fun to make? Highlights of series two of engineering connections are possibly landing on the deck of HMS Illustrious, because landing in a helicopter on an aircraft carrier as a boy or as a girl is pretty exciting, so that was a tremendous privilege. I think climbing around some of these structures to just places that are not open to us usually, because we're making program, we can get sort of standing on the roof of Sydney Opera House, climbing down from the road deck, the main bridge on the top of a 245 metre tall tower, getting to go to places that we don't normally get to go to, and I'll probably never get to go to again. That was a privilege. Obviously, every project, place, machine that we're making program about has to be chosen, and it's a lengthy process, and one of the great things about engineering connections about the two making is everybody's opinion counts, everybody's ideas must be heard. And that's great, it's a measure of the fact that, well, you're not carrying any dead weight on the team, every member of the team is there for a reason, and that reason is the brain, what the computer is, whether their job is operating a camera, organising things, or driving a car, they're all there because of the brains. And so the process is simply one of, well, getting everybody's checking their opinions. And what you're looking for, obviously, is something that is going to make for an exciting film, actually, when you film the object itself, be an aircraft carrier, a bridge, or an opera, or a football ground, or a museum. But also, it's got to be something that we can find the connections to. As yet, it seems to be, and maybe this is praise from the team, but it seems to be that every time we find something that we look at and think that is intrinsically interesting in and of itself to make a film about it, immediately we always will then find the connections. Whether it's connecting Wembley Stadium to a medieval panic when it was used to roll back across there before we fired it, or whether it's connecting the arch to gliders' wooden wheel in the place we make intention to really make the bicycle wheel. And there's always, they're always there to dig deep enough, we always find the connections. When we got to Hong Kong Airport, it's hard to keep reminding yourself that what you're looking at didn't exist. I don't mean like the airport infrastructure, the runways, the tower didn't exist. The place didn't exist, it was just some sea. So they made an island to put the airport on. So when you're standing there on the tarmac at the airport itself, you're thinking, not only could you not land an aircraft because there wasn't a runway here, there was nothing. It was just sea. And that's, it took some getting my head back. The most striking feature about Wembley, I guess, is the things that's what it's like to be. All the millions of those iconic things you can see from 13 miles away. So it's an enormous thing. Obviously, something so enormous capable of supporting that roof had to be made and then lifted up into place. And we found a fascinating connection with the machines they used to do it. They couldn't use a crane. They used something called stand jacks, which are incredibly powerful machines. And essentially, could pull the thing upwards. And we connected those back to a thing called a crossbar, which was invented by a bloke called Will. Crossbar, everything on board. And it's a safety knot they used for moving up ropes. So essentially what you have is a rope, hang off it, it's a cliff face, and you have two ropes of rope with special knots, and you can move from that, and you move the other rope, and then you move the other rope, and you move that rope. Essentially you press on one, move that rope, then you hang off this one, you move that rope, then you press on that one, and move that rope. And that's exactly the same as the way to stand jacks. So we made that connection. Unfortunately, in making that connection, I had to climb up a cliff face using crossbar ropes, which is not only hard work, it's also for somebody who runs over hiding it, even with the heights, it's quite terrifying. I never used to be at all until my eldest daughter was born, was it, 8 years ago. And from that moment, it was like a switch was thrown. From that moment on, I was scared of heights. What's also remarkable is how many really high things the team decided I had to climb up, stand on, look at in the course of making this scene. A lot of very high things. I spent a lot of time, I'll be honest, in the course of making these engineering connections too, really scared. Because at 0.9, you'll see, at one point I climbed down from the Mayor Bridge, which is 245 metres above the town valley, and the road deck, which is a huge hollow metal deck, was walking on the inside of, and the French engineer threw open a hatch, there it is, and looked down, and there's a 245 metre drop to the valley floor below, offset from the hole of the hatch. The top of one of the towers that I was supposed to stand on. And he set a ladder from a hole diagonally across over the yawning chasm to the top of the tower. I had to climb down the ladder to the top of the tower and conduct an interview. I did it, but it wasn't empty interview. Some of the connections are really quite unexpected, which is good. And for instance, connecting the average, which is a bridge in the world, to a gecko sliding down a frying pan full one in my kitchen at home. And the connection is Teflon, bear with me, it's because they had to slide the road they had across the towers, for which they devised this astonishingly clever system of wedges and jacks. You'll see it on the program. These wedges are lifting thousands of tons of rope, they have to move over one another, which means when quite friction, they won't move. So you need a very slippery substance. That's where the Teflon demonstrate how slippery it really is, by conducting the now, as I said, internationally recognised gecko test. I demonstrated the gecko with this glass, it could stick to the ground. I demonstrated the same gecko on an upturned frying pan, couldn't fit every second. So you see, there is a link between the tallest bridge in the world and a gecko on a frying pan. But you wouldn't have seen that coming anyway, so you could have stuck on that one. Some of the demonstrations always become more, let's say, dynamic than others, and this series, something I think really beautiful, I built my own post-tension arch, demonstrating what post-tension is actually doing. Tremendous of these things in your past, it's rather beautiful. Equally though, I managed to drop, well, it was a brick, through bits of huge and glass from that 100 feet up in Jericho. It was really boring, exciting to go on to discover, well, to discuss discovering laminated glass now, but maybe it's quite a lot of fun. But probably the most exciting was when we demonstrated how a wooden wheel wouldn't work very well on a glider, because Michael Caine was trying to devise the world's first manned glider, wonderful gliders. The problem we had was the wheels, the hill was available to him, but wouldn't, and they wouldn't stand up to the impact of landing. I knew the theory, I just thought it was something that we needed to demonstrate graphically to see. What we needed to do, right, was get a bicycle, come on a bicycle. Fit it instead of a tension, which is what the job of the invention was coming on to, instead of a tension wire spoke wheel, we fit it with an old-fashioned wooden spoke wheel, and then get somebody else, not me, a stuntman, to jump it, land it, and see what happened. Obviously, the wheel would shatter, and it landed into place. But well, it wasn't measures rather than true standard gauge. And was it again, I mean the signs, I knew that a standard gauge that I used on board using as an original wooden aircraft wouldn't stay 2 bits left here, and demonstrated by sticking 2 bits of metal together with wood and seeing that I couldn't lift the car by it because when the bomb would snap. When we did it with epoxy, it worked, it lifted the whole car. But these 2 bits of metal that being stuck together, that was the joint, it lifted the whole car. But there was a kind of tension there because I thought, that's really clever, can we put it down now because at some point it's going to snap off. The privilege of getting to look behind the scenes at places where we never normally get to see, and of meeting often some of the people involved in designing them. But one of the greatest privileges is, well, think about it, I'm a party, and looking around for something to talk about. Oh, I can't remember, because I just turned around and said, did you know that there was a direct link between a roof that were near Wembley and a medieval crinoline, which is a machine devised to give you gearing and mechanical advantages to fire across it. Did you know that? And I've got a conversation right there straight away. What I've got, in fact, is a whole television series worth of explanations. I'm deadly against.